for the first time.
TV Land Legends, the 60 Minutes Interviews. Catch the 4-episode premiere featuring Jackie Gleason, Johnny Carson, Carol Burnett, and Jerry Seinfeld. Next, on TV Land.
When you've got good ratings, and you're 1, 2, or 3 in the ratings, there is nothing your little heart desires that they don't provide.
Welcome to TV Land Legends, the 60 Minutes Interviews. I'm Ed Bradley. They called him the Great One. The immortal Jackie Gleason did it all. Vaudeville, dramatic films, the theater. But his reputation rests on just 39 sitcom episodes about a blustering bus driver named Ralph Cramden and his long-suffering wife, Alice. The Honeymooners, first broadcast on CBS in 1955 and rerun all over the world with rarely a break ever since, made Gleason one of television's first superstars. He made it up as he went along and created a classic that continues to entertain almost half a century later. When Morley Safer spoke to him in 1984, he found a man who, after 50-odd years in show business, was still calling his own shots.
Sure you haven't got any money?
No. All it's right. Against company rules.
We'll play for fun.
Portrait of a 68-year-old hustler and some memories. Herbert John Gleason, whose appetite for excess made him larger than life in every way, who pranced and partied from Brooklyn to Broadway, who rolled over the networks and the film studios to get what he wanted, who can't read, write, or play a note of music, but who sold millions of records of his made-up melodies, who performed feats of pure fancy as light-fingered as a jewel thief. Jackie Gleason is a natural, never studied or rehearsed, planned or practiced. He's winged it all his life.
And away we go!
50 years ago, a teenage wise guy with barely an act, and away he went.
I went to a place called Tiny Chateau, and I had this stale act of impersonations and a couple of real bad jokes. And I went on and did the first show, and they were all miners in boots and real tough crowd. Well, they almost booed me off. And Tiny, who was naturally 7 foot tall, when I came off, he said, "Come here." And he took me over to the phone, and he dropped quarters in to call New York. And everybody at the bar turned around and watched. And he got Solly Shore on the phone. He says, "How can you send me a bum like this?"
In front of the audience?
Yeah, in front of the people at the bar. And when Tiny hung up, he looked at me. And I guess I had that poor soul look up. And he felt safe. He said, "Come on, I'll buy you a drink." So we had 1, 2, 3, maybe 15 drinks. And it's time for the second show. I went out and I killed people. I did somersaults, told jokes I never heard, played the piano, which I can't play. And when I came off, Tony said, "Well, why didn't you do that in the first show?" I said, "Well, you know, I'm just breaking in." So the next night, when I came downstairs, I tried to remember what I had done. And I knew the only way to remember was go to the bar and have about 15 drinks, and it would come to me.
In those days, of course, no television. And the next best thing, I guess, was Hollywood.
I got $2.50 a week at Warner Brothers, and they put me in gangster pictures.
Hollywood wasn't sure what to do with the 25-year-old comic. He played the heavy in a few B-movies, then headed back east, his dreams of stardom on hold.
So then I came back to New York when a guy from Dumont saw me, and they wanted to replace the comedian on the Dumont network that was doing Cavalcade of Stars. 2 weeks at $600 was the contract.
Did you think there'd be no future for television?
No, as far as I was concerned, it was just the job. At that time, I didn't think I had anything for television.
The Dumont network folded in a few years, but from the Cavalcade of Stars show came a cavalcade of Gleason characters. The poor soul. Reginald Van Gleason III. And a minor sketch about a Brooklyn couple and their upstairs neighbors that would evolve into a half-hour comedy on CBS.
Don't you understand? Vaughn and I, we chip in $300 and we make $2,000. $2,000, Alan. That's big, big, big. This is probably the biggest thing I ever got into.
The biggest thing you ever got into was your pants.
Alice and Ralph Cramden, the Honeymooners.
Being a Weisenheimer, Alice.
Bickering long before Edith and Archie Bunker. It was kitchen sink drama played for laughs.
Are you gonna give me the money?
No.
But the laughs were drawn from the painful childhood of Gleason himself. Comedy rooted, if not in tragedy, then in poverty.
Bang, zoom!
Round table, the dismal surroundings and the icebox and the bureau. And everything went into the bureau.
Was that like the Gleason household?
Yeah. My mother had to work because my father had left when I was about 8 years old. And she had to work, so she couldn't take care of the home or the house or the flat very well and work at the same time. But she was a good mother, and everything was very pleasant, even though it was desultory.
You mean not a lot of affection?
Oh, there was a lot of affection. But the place was dull. The bulbs weren't very bright. And the surroundings, of course, were very bare.
Any of the stage business with that couple that you drew from?
There were many Cramdens in Brooklyn. Almost everybody was a Cramden in this particular neighborhood that I lived in.
Pretty lousy husband.
Well, no, not really, Morley. When you think of him, the poor soul hasn't got a hell of a lot of ability. But he keeps trying. He gets schemes, and his schemes are all to make he and Alice happy. And he fails. And when he fails, she feels a great deal of affection. She knows why he did it. And he apologizes all the time.
Of course, with all the bluff, he's...
He's just an ordinary moke that's trying to make it and just can't do it, that's all.
In many ways, Ralph Cramden was the forerunner for Archie Bunker. I mean, in many ways, they're the same guy.
Well, O'Connor sent me a letter one time saying, I know I'm doing a lot of things that you did. And I sent him a letter back saying, I wish I'd done all the things you're doing.
The golf swing. First, step up. Plant your feet firmly on the ground and address the ball.
How much of the success was due to Norton?
What do they mean by address the ball?
I say 90%. I'll give him 90%. He's just great. He was wonderful.
Step up. Plant your feet firmly. Hello, ball.
Why is this show as successful now, practically, in reruns, as it was the first time round? There are only 39 shows.
I could give you 20 academic answers to that.
No.
But
give me Jackie Gleason's answer.
It's funny.
More of The Great One when TV Land Legends returns.
This TV Land event is brought to you by M&M's.
Welcome to the Gamgort. Checking in?
Yeah.
Would you like a free newspaper in the morning?
Sure.
And how about our turndown service with a complimentary chocolate on your pillow?
Great.
Can I watch TV?
No.
From the makers of Uno, Boomo. It's a blast to play.
Hi. You ordered the Chicago Dish, our new deep dish pizza? Now, I warn you, this is no ordinary pizza. This baby is so deep, you'll need a fork.
Sounds good.
Tired of wimpy, paper-thin pizzas? Next time, go deep with the Chicago Dish Pizza, new from Pizza Hut. Filled to the brim with layers of cheese, overloaded with toppings, and topped off with chunky marinara sauce. The new Chicago Dish. Go deep. So deep you'll need a fork. Maybe even a knife.
Wow. You guys are really into your utensils.
What do you wonder about? Do you wonder if they're reading enough? If they understand the importance of friendship? Do you wonder what the day looks like through their eyes? It's funny, though, the crazy things you wonder. Because somewhere out there, there are a million other parents wondering the exact same thing. National PTA. Every child, one voice.
Just because a toothbrush is electric doesn't mean it works like a Sonicare. It has patented Sonic technology. Whiter, healthier teeth in 28 days, guaranteed. Ask your dental professional about Sonicare.
You're watching a special premiere night of TV Land Legends, the 60-Minute Interviews, a new series. Conversations with TV's most fascinating characters. Starting next week, tune in every Sunday at 10 p.m. for TV Land Legends, the 60-Minute Interviews.
And now, back to TV Land Legends. The term living large might have been invented for Jackie Gleason. He rose from the depths of poverty, a poor Irish Catholic boy from Brooklyn whose dad disappeared when he was eight and whose mother worked as a subway token booth clerk to support them. After a decade of telling jokes in tough joints, TV made him an overnight sensation. He took great pleasure in all the perks that went with it.
Any performer that says he hasn't got a nigga is a liar. How can you command $200,000, $300,000 a night to do a show in front of a million people and say that you're humble? It's commercial naivete. It's not for real. You got to think a hell of a lot of yourself in order to just get out there and look at them.
And Gleason was never shy about flexing his star power. Just one season after signing a record-breaking deal with CBS and Buick, which not only put him in the driver's seat on camera, but gave him final say over every aspect of the production, plus ownership of the program, he decided he didn't want to do the Honeymooners anymore. He agreed to host a weekly variety show with dancing girls and guest stars, but only if it could be done in Miami Beach.
When we're doing the Honeymooners, I had a big contract for that for 2 years, and after the first year, I said I didn't want to do it, and they didn't believe me. They thought I had a job somewhere else. And finally, they realized that I just didn't want to do it. And when they approached me to do another show, I was in California making a picture, and I said, all right. I said, but I want a train that goes to Florida, because I had come down here and played golf and liked it, and I figured, might as well go to Florida and do the show, play golf all the time. And they went for it.
What was on that train?
Everything. We had two Dixieland bands come from California. They would spell each other. I'd say to them, take 5 miles. And parties went on 24. I found out that I couldn't attend the parties.
Were there girls on that train?
Were there girls? There certainly were. And they were very, very nice girls. Nothing untoward happened. Might have been because the berths were too small, but regardless of that, nothing happened on that train.
And was there a bar on that train?
A bar? The train was a bar.
I guess that's a classic example of what clout is.
Yes.
To say, a train, please.
That's right. When you've got good ratings, and you're 1, 2, or 3 in the ratings, and there is.
You were making extraordinary money, $10, $11, $15 million, when $15 million. But you've always lived, I'm told, way over your head, even when you were earning a really.
It up with, and then the other for security.
But when you were spending, I mean, it was excessive with the Rolls Royces and the trains and the handouts and the Almost.
I should have had more respect for money. Because I never had any. And I don't know why. And I also had no fear when I should have had fear. For instance, the way they used to get you in television, they would get you to paint yourself into a corner of luxury. Then they would start to dictate. Because they knew that you feared losing that money. And so you'd give up your independence and go along with them. It was threats to your security and kudos to your ego. That's how they operated. But I learned that on the corner of Chauncey Street in Brooklyn when I was a little kid. And I knew when they were telling me how great I was that they had something coming up next that they wanted. Or wanted me to do.
You once had a television show that probably without doubt was about the worst show ever on television.
Oh, you're in the picture. A beauty.
We roll out some pictures. The panelists put their heads into holes that have been cut into the pictures. Now, they can't see what the picture is because we have a little collar under their chin. They try to guess what the content of the picture is or what they portray in the picture.
What possessed you to do?
Well, all I can tell you that there were perhaps 30 executives in CBS who thought it was the funniest thing they had ever seen in their life. I began to think it was the funniest thing I had ever seen in my life. And then we did it, and crash. And I went to CBS and I said, I've got to go on next week and apologize to the audience. I can't. They said, what are you talking? This is a network. You can't do that.
Last week, we did a show called You're in the Picture. That laid. Without a doubt. The biggest bomb.
And the critics hailed them for it. You know, said, gee, at last the network is apologizing for a bomb.
How does that happen? How is such a dumb idea?
Because there are executives who have a great talent. And that talent is to say yes, that sounds like no, or no, that sounds like yes. So they continue in their jobs because they have this great talent. I might have been drinking too much, but I went along with it.
Were you drinking a lot in those days?
Not on show day. I would drink the rest of the week. You couldn't exist at Tuchar's unless you had a few bombs during the day.
What was Tuchar's then, really a club?
Tuchar's was the corner candy store that you hung out in when you were a kid, but this one was for adults. I'd get there at 11 o'clock before the joint was open and had a few warm-ups at the bar, and I wouldn't leave until 4, 4:30 in the afternoon, go home, take a shower, get dressed, and back for dinner. And the same guys were there, and the same fun was going on.
Why did you drink so much?
I like to drink. I had a lot of fun drinking. I know that drinking is a tragedy to some people. They lose their jobs, they lose their wives, their families. But it never happened that way with me.
Why do I drink? Because I don't like to be chipped.
Perhaps it was art imitating life. But Gleason proved he could act as Joe the Lush in Saroyan's The Time of Your Life for Playhouse 90.
Now I don't do anything. I live all the time.
And as Minnesota Fats in The Hustler.
Weapon. Oh, he is great. Geez, that old fat man. Look at the way he moves like a dancer.
You were, at your height, I guess, the most successful man on television, and maybe even now you're past that. You may still have been the most successful guy ever been on television. And yet there have been no awards from television.
No. I won the Tony on Broadway. I was nominated for an Emmy once. But that's as far as it's strange that the business that I devoted most of my endeavor to that there shouldn't be some award. Now, Audrey, I believe, got an Emmy. Art did. June Taylor did when we were doing the variety show. Everybody got an Emmy but me.
Never mind the awards. What's the psychic kick you get from the work you do?
Well, the thing that made me want to go into show business, I was in a graduation play in grammar school, and I got a laugh. That laugh is the greatest thing could possibly happen to you. And if you can go out in front of an audience and do things that make them happy and make them laugh, there's no greater thrill. The instant critique of laughter. And when you achieve that, it's great. It's wonderful.
TV Land Legends will return in a moment.
Honey, come here. You gotta see this. This is so cool. Anywhere he touches in the whole thing, music. Isn't that great? And when you turn the page, he'll learn shapes. Oh, okay. Right here, he's learning numbers, all the numbers. And he's going to learn the alphabet, the whole alphabet. And
it says introducing the Leap Start learning table from LeapFrog.
He'll learn his letters over here. He'll learn
to stand.
From the first time they pull up to exploring letters, numbers, music, and more, there's an entire symphony of learning.
Whoa.
LeapFrog. Learn something new every day.
Anna?
Polaroid film is good.
I feel a little sinus pressure here, but that's just the start.
Slight twinge of pressure right here, but I know it's going to get worse.
The first sign of sinus pressure. That's your signal for Sudafed. Sinus pressure can escalate to sinus pain, but taking Sudafed sooner relieves pressure to help keep symptoms from getting worse.
Take non-drowsy Sudafed at
your first sign and help stop sinus pain before it starts.
And for nighttime sinus relief, try Sudafed Sinus Nighttime.
Play a secret agent?
Irresistible. I get to outsmart the bad guys and look disarmingly beautiful.
The limited edition 007 color collection, inspired by Bond, created by Revlon. See Halle Berry in Die Another Day.
Only from Revlon.
Welcome to the Gamgort. Checking in?
Yeah.
Would you like a free newspaper in the morning?
Sure.
And how about our turndown service with a complimentary chocolate on your pillow?
Great.
Can I watch TV?
No.
Tired of spending nights alone? Of friends fixing you up on dead-end dates? Are the cards of love stacked against you? Then pick up the phone and call the Matchlink Singles Network. It's safe, confidential, free to enroll, and you don't have to browse through hundreds of ads to be matched with someone you're compatible with. We've all had our fair share of jokers in the game of love, but with the Matchlink Singles Network, anyone can bring home a winner.
Would you buy a lunch in a brown paper bag if its contents were unknown? That's like buying a mattress when you don't know what's inside. All you see is the outside wrapper. At the Original Mattress Factory, we love to show you what's inside. Heavy gauge coils, stitch cotton padding, Amish built wood frames, and we show you mattresses under the wrapper so you can see and feel the difference. We'll save you hundreds of dollars because we eliminate the middleman. The Original Mattress Factory, genuine value from the inside out.
And now, back to TV Land Legends.
Ralph Cramden never did get out of Brooklyn, but Jackie Gleason took his revenge by living very well.
Oh, how sweet it is. Oh.
He and his third wife, Marilyn, are rebuilding their Florida home into the ultimate playhouse.
In the other room, the game room, we have a crap table from Vegas.
It is, as he puts it, a prolonged vacation.
Knocking down mailboxes.
A movie every few years, usually playing Smokey to Burt Reynolds' Bandit. Not even a heart attack 6 years ago has curbed his desire for La Dolce Vita, or his habit of smoking 5 packs a day. He has painted himself into that corner of luxury and has managed to stay there despite a lifelong belief that having fun is better than having money.
You did tell an interviewer once that your greatest fear in life was not making heaven.
Yes, if there is a heaven and hell, certainly anybody's fear is not making heaven. Who wants to go to hell?
If you didn't make heaven, I suspect you could hustle your way in, though.
No, I don't think so. No, that's too much for real to con your way in.
Do you think you'd deserve to?
Go to heaven?
Mm.
If the rules are true of what you have to do to get to heaven, I certainly don't deserve going there. But if God is what he has been said to be, I'm sure that he isn't vengeful. I'm sure that if you've committed a sin, he's not going to send you to hell for eternity.
You think he's got a sense of humor?
He must have. He made us. He must have a wonderful sense of humor. Do you like that one, pal?
Tell me something. The great one. Where did that come from?
Well, Orson Welles called me the great one first. And then Lucy started to call me that. And I'm really not offended by it.
Did you ever really believe it?
You just saw me play pool, didn't you?
Jackie Gleason always dreamed of making a film about his own rags-to-riches life story with his pal, Orson Welles. It never came to fruition, but the Great One realized more dreams than most mere mortals. He spent the last years of his life working with such diverse talents as Laurence Olivier, Richard Pryor, and Tom Hanks. 3 years after his pool game with Morley Safer, he died in 1987 at the age of 71. The inscription on his tombstone is just four words. And away we go. For TV Land Legends, the 60 Minutes Interviews, I'm Ed Bradley.
You're watching the premiere night of TV Land Legends, the 60 Minutes Interviews. Up next, take a rare personal visit with the legendary king of late night, Johnny Carson, right here on TV Land.